hope you've been thinking about that question I raised earlier. Why has God given you a place to live? Now, I know that most of you here live in homes. Sometimes they're yours, and sometimes maybe you're living with your parents or something like that. But most of you here have your own home, and you're in control of the place that you live. And my question is this: why has God primarily given you that home? Whether you're renting, living with someone, why has God given you a place to live? Well, maybe like most people would say, he's given you a retreat from the world. You got a place that you can go home every night and get away from everybody else. You can get some rest. And this is one of the, this goes back to our understanding of our culture. And our culture wants to have personal peace. It wants to get away from people. And you rest. You watch TV. You watch your VCR, your VHS, your RCA, or whatever they are that you're watching. And you get away from people. But there's a problem with that, because if you're a Christian today, Jesus said that my prayer is not that you would take them out of the world. Moreover, he said, I send them into the world. God doesn't want you to retreat by yourself. So it's not that. It's not a retreat from the world. How about let's spiritualize it. Let's make it a little more religious. Maybe God gave you a home so that you'd have a place to pray and to fast. Certainly that's spiritual. Certainly if we went over to your home and wondered what you were doing and we found you praying and fasting, we would be impressed. You're spending your time alone with God, seeking to know his will. But there's a problem with that too. In Isaiah 58, Isaiah describes a true fast this way. He said, is it not to share your food with the hungry, to provide the poor wanderer with shelter, and when you see him naked to clothe him, and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood? So in other words, your home isn't just for you to do your private religious exercises. Oh, and we want you to read the scriptures, and we want you to pray, and we want you to fast and seek the Lord. But God did not give you a home that you would have a private religious retreat either. I'll give you another option. How about God gave you your home as a way to show love to strangers? That's the answer that we're looking for this morning. I'm glad you came up with it. That is exactly why God gave you resources in your life and gave you a place to live. Take your Bibles and go with me to 1 Peter chapter 4. We're looking at verse 9. Rhonda read this verse earlier, and the verses around it. You know, we've been dealing with the mandates of the Apostle Peter and all of the different initiatives that he wants Christians that are in the church to have within their individual lives. And we talked how grace produces faith in the lives of Christians. Faith produces obedience. There's the obedience of faith. The obedience of faith always leads to the purity of heart and holiness. Holiness leads to love. And today we're going to talk about hospitality as a demonstration of and the primary demonstration that God has called Christians to have of love within their life. 1 Peter 4, verse 9. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. This word hospitality, by the way, is a Greek word. It's a combination of two words, phileo, which is one of the Greek words for brotherly affection, for brotherly love, and the word for stranger, which is xenos. Phileo, xenos, brotherly love, or literally the love of a stranger. And God calls us as Christians, as an expression of our love, to show love to strangers. When's the last time you invited someone into your home that was a stranger to you? Someone that you didn't really know very well, And you said, you know what? Because God calls me to use my home as a place to show love to people, because he's blessed me with a place to live, I'm going to invite such and such over and get to know them. When's the last time that you did that? And the mandate of Peter that we have to deal with today is that we need to be hospitable without what? Grumbling. Are you grumbling yet? Are you already sitting there going, well, you don't understand my situation. And yet when I look at this in the church, it is one of the most important dynamics that needs to be present in the body of Christ. And if it isn't there, the body suffers. Why is it important? Vance Packard's book, A Nation of Strangers, Jack Sparks critiques. He says this, that the outstanding characteristic that Packard found was rootlessness in people. They do not have a sense of belonging. He also suggests that personal fulfillment requires that we have common purpose with people that know us and care for us. In other words, the issue is, how are we going to get to know people better in our community? How are we going to be able to reach out to those that come in from the community and into the church? How are we going to get to know them and care for them? Ray Netherly goes on to write, he says, ours is a nation of strangers, and this personal isolationism is sweeping the church. In other words, the problem isn't just out there in our society, that the problem today is in the church, and it's in the people of God. And if you're here today, you're either a victim of this isolationism, or you're a perpetrator of this isolationism. And if you're like me, you probably fall right in between both of them. That we have a tendency to be isolated because we want to be isolated, and we have a tendency to be isolated because we do not open our hearts and our homes to the people around us. Why should we care about those that we do not know well? After all, that person is sitting in that aisle. That person isn't like me. That person is older. That person is younger. They're just different. Why should we be willing to reach out and show hospitality to others? Well, let's answer that as we consider the command to pursue hospitality with strangers. Pursue hospitality with strangers. I hope you have your sermon notes there. You need them, because in our midweeks, you're going to be discussing this very issue this week. So get your sermon notes out. Make sure that you take notes. And if you have questions, write them down, because you're going to be able to address those in our midweek studies. Pursue hospitality with strangers. Go with me over to the book of Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12, and as Paul moves from the proclamation of the gospel and the work of Christ into how Christians are supposed to live, in Romans chapter 12, if you look down to verse 13, Paul writes this, share with God's people who are in need, practice hospitality. Share with God's people who are in need, practice the love of strangers. And this, by the way, this Greek word here for practice, and if you have a different version, it might say pursue hospitality. It might say be given to hospitality. And the whole idea here is that it would be the type of thing that you would pursue in your life just like a calling. Just like a calling. We understand when we say someone is called into the ministry. And if someone is called into the ministry, we say, well, you know, that person has to orient everything in their life around that calling. We have high expectations of people that are called into the ministry. And we have Scott here, our apprentice. And Scott, if you know Scott's practices in his life, he orients his whole life pretty much so around the ministry. And matter of fact, I was looking at his schedule in the upcoming weeks, and I think we've got just about every night of the week but one scheduled up for him, and he's going to be devoted to ministry. And that's a good thing. And we would expect that when it's your calling, that you'd be devoted to that. But when it comes to this issue of hospitality, this is an issue that the Bible teaches us that we're to be devoted to like a calling. Matter of fact, the Living Bible says in relationship to this verse, and it's the only time in 10 years I've quoted the Living Bible, but I will do so this morning. And he says, get in the habit of inviting others home for dinner. Get in the habit of inviting others home for dinner. Now that's pretty clear and that's pretty understandable. It's supposed to be something that's out, you know, part of our life. You know, if someone come up to you and said, what makes you a Christian? You know, what does a Christian do? What does a Christian believe? We would probably say something, well, you know, we believe in God. We believe in Jesus Christ, his son, and we believe that you need to be saved by receiving him into your life and believing on his work 2,000 years ago on the cross, his death, burial, and resurrection. And then we believe that you need to live a life of holiness. We probably say something like that. But how often would we say, well, you know, now that I'm a Christian, here's something else that I also believe. I believe that we need to be practicers of hospitality. And that along with believing in Christ, believing in the Trinity, believing in salvation by grace through faith, I believe that as a Christian, my main calling is to be hospitable and to use the resources that God has given me to reach out and to love others. How many of us would do that? Why should we have such a passion for loving strangers? I'm going to give you four reasons today why you should have a passion to reach out and love those that you do not know. Number one, because God loves strangers. God demonstrates his graciousness as a characteristic of who he is in the loving of strangers. And guess who those strangers are? Take your Bible and go with me to the book of Ephesians chapter 2. Who are those strangers that God has loved? Ephesians chapter 2, let's read from verses 11 to 13. Therefore, remember that formerly you who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, that done in the body by the hands of men, remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners, or strangers, the word is, to the covenants of promise, without hope, and without God in the world. But now how? In Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ. Why should we love strangers? Because God demonstrates his love for strangers in that he didn't just settle with the people that he loved and cared about and purposed to make a name for himself. He loved strangers, and we as the Gentiles are those strangers. It comes out of the character of God. It is a display of the wonderful, matchless grace of God. And see, the Bible teaches is that if we receive the grace of God, and God has chosen us to be representatives in this world of who he is and his character to the world, then we have to display that same grace to others. So God loves strangers. And because God loves strangers, we should love strangers. Secondly, because Jesus identifies with strangers. Jesus identifies with strangers. You remember what Jesus said when he looked over Jerusalem and he was coming in on Palm Sunday and he looked over the city and he wept and he said, you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you. Jesus identifies with strangers because Jesus was a stranger himself. That's the way he lived in this world. Take your Bibles and go with me to the book of Matthew chapter 25. Matthew chapter 25. Here, and this is a parable. It's in parabolic form as Jesus is teaching under the law. and teaching judgment that will occur under the law and not under grace, but you need to understand that as a framework behind this parable. But Jesus talks about how we're supposed to be in relationship to attitude to those that we do not know and those that are in need. But let's begin at Matthew 25, and let's begin in verse 31. Long parable, we'll get through it quickly though. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his throne in heaven in glory. And all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right hand and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father. Take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was what? Stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me. And then the righteous are going to answer him. Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you? Or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you? It's a good question. They didn't remember doing that. Certainly the world rejected Christ, but his disciples are saying, wait a minute, Lord, we didn't do that to you. We, of course, wouldn't do that to you. What does Jesus say in verse 40? The king will reply, I tell you the truth, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. And then he will say to those that are on his left, depart from me, you who are cursed, and into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes, and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison, and you did not look after me. And then again, as you look down in verse 45, as they ask him again, when did we do this? He will reply, I tell you the truth. Whatever you did not do for one of the least of these, you did not do for me. Jesus came into the world, and this really is a description of the rejection of Christ by the nation of Israel. And they rejected him, and they said, you know, we're not interested. You're a stranger to us. We've got the law, and we've got the we've been chosen by God, and we got the worship of the temple. We've got all this stuff. We don't need to love you. And they rejected the Son of God. But here, Jesus, in his identification with strangers, says, now, if you are now in my community, if you are one of my brothers, and this is the way that you treat others, this is the way that you're treating me. We talk about today, you know, I want to be like Christ. I want to be like Jesus, right? I want to do what Jesus does. Then we have to love strangers. Why? Because Jesus identifies with strangers. Look around here this morning. Is there anybody here that's a stranger to you? You do not know well. Maybe you don't know at all. I mean, it's pretty safe in the church. We're not even talking about going out there. Any strangers for you to invite in? Because Jesus identifies with strangers, so should we. Thirdly today, because there are angels in our midst. Because there's angels in our midst. Go to Hebrews chapter 13. I think this is really cool. Hebrews chapter 13, look at verse 1. Keep on loving each other as brothers. You know, here's that phileo adelphos again. Philadelphia, the love of brothers. So he says, keep on loving each other as brothers. And then look at verse 2. Do not forget to entertain strangers, for by so doing, some people have entertained angels without knowing it. In the beginning of Hebrews, in Hebrews chapter 1, angels are those ministering spirits that are sent out to minister salvation for the people of God. And so what is the writer of the Hebrews saying here? He's saying that you, if you are hospitable and you reach out to strangers, not just those people you know, you might entertain an angel someday in your midst. Now, I've had a lot of you over to my house, and I'm not sure that any of you are angels. I'm not saying it's not the way that you're acting. I'm not saying that. Don't take it that way. But it's possible that there's an angel in our midst. And it's possible when the community starts to come in that God is going to say to us as a church, I'm going to test them. And I'm going to send my angel. And let's see what his experience is as he goes to Fair Park Community Church. Let's see if someone will reach out to him as a stranger and invite him in. You know why? Because if they do, it shows that they're willing to receive me in their midst. That's the teaching of the scripture. There are angels in our midst. What a great blessing. You would be missing and your family would be missing if you failed and neglected to bring people into your home and missed having an angel sit at your table. Because there are angels in our midst, number three. Number four, because you participate in the progress of the gospel. That's really why we're here. Remember, Jesus said, just as you sent me, as he's praying to his Father, so send I you, he says, to his people, to his apostles. And we've been sent by God to go into the world to bring the light of the gospel of Christ. So we're supposed to participate in the progress of the gospel. And one of the ways that we do that is by planting churches in areas that we believe need to hear the clear gospel of Jesus Christ and what it means to be saved by faith in the work of Christ alone, apart from works. But now God has called you and you've stepped forward out of another church to say, I want to go, Lord, send me. Well, then what do we need to do? And certainly most of you here have ministries, and that's good. Everybody here, as far as I know, is working in different ministries to serve in this community so that when people come in, we are going to be a church that's going to have Sunday school and Bible studies and different types of ministries to outreach to people. But it needs to go farther than that if we're going to participate in the progress of the gospel. And it comes down to how do you live your daily lives with the resources that God has given you? Well, there's two ways that I believe that you can participate in the progress of the gospel. Number one, you can encourage ministers of the gospel. You can encourage missionary type people, people that are gifted and called to the ministry that are doing a lion's share of the job for you. Third John, book of Third John. Only one chapter. Go there with me, please. 3 John. And here in this book, John is writing to a fellow minister of the gospel. His name was Gaius, about some issues of the church where he was at. And there was a man in the church here and his name was Diotrephes. And Diotrephes was the type of person that said, this is my ministry, and I don't want anybody else infringing on my territory. And so if there's any other ministers coming around, they're going to get rejected from my church. There's going to be no competition here. And John writes to Gaius, and he says, dear friend, you are faithful in what you are doing for the brothers, even though they are strangers to you. They have told the church about your love. You will do well to send them on their way in a manner worthy of God. It was for the sake of the name that they went out, receiving no help from the pagans. We ought therefore to show what? Hospitality. Phileo Sinia. the love of strangers to such men, so that we may work together for the truth. Do you want to participate with the ministers, the missionaries, those that God has called to devote their whole lives to the service of the gospel? Do you want to participate in their ministry? Then it's time that you take these men and women that are participating in ministry. And in our church, you know, we deal with ministers specifically, and we train ministers, that you take them into your homes and you find out what it means to be blessed and be a blessing to them by being an encouragement to them. Now I ask you, now I think you would find it to be embarrassing if we were to ask each and every one of you, when is the last time that you had a minister from this church, or even in terms of the Cambodian ministry, that when the Cambodians ministers came into town, when was the last time that you had one of the ministers that you're associated with, that this church is associated with, in your home? I think most of us would be embarrassed to give an answer to that question. How many of you have had Scott into your home? You're his brother. Okay. Two. Good. But see, this, you know, people, ministers of the gospel, they're not some type of extraordinary people that don't have feelings and that don't need to have relationships with people that care about them and know them well also. And often it is those that work the hardest in the ministry in the church and those that spend the most time that feel the greatest isolationism in the midst of their community. So the first way that you can participate in the progress of the gospel is to encourage ministers, encourage those significant workers that are called into service of Christ. Number two, another reason, or another way you can participate, reason to participate in the progress of the gospel, so that you can help grow the church. See, the church will not grow. This church will not grow as a community if you don't begin to use your homes, number one, to reach out to those that are just around you so that you can get to know them well and be an encouragement to them. But then when people begin to walk through this door that you do not know, that you'll be willing to invite them over. They'll experience the love of Christ through you. That's the number one way they're going to discover who he is. Because you are going to reach out to them and show love to them. Go with me to Luke chapter 14. Luke chapter 14. Verse 12. When Jesus said to his host, when you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers, or relatives, or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back, and so you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. What is he saying? Is he saying, you know, that we're really not supposed to reach out to those around us that we know? No, he's not saying that. But he's saying, I want to change your orientation and the way that you think about being a servant and a minister of the gospel as a people of God. When you begin to think about having a party, you know, we had a Super Bowl party, and we have different types of parties in our culture for different types of holidays and events, right? Birthdays and anniversaries and graduations and all those things. And what he's saying is when you begin to think about having a celebration, Don't be thinking, well, you know what? I'm going to invite all my close friends because, you know that will really be comfortable for me. And we can really be relaxed. He's saying, don't think about just inviting your close friends because you know what? They're going to repay you anyway. They're going to invite you over to their home sometime. But if you really want to please God, if you really want treasure in heaven, and you want to be rewarded by Christ, go out and invite people that are spiritually destitute. And in some cases, maybe even need a physical touch. Next time you have a party, let's think about that. Look out at the church community, those that have come into the church community, and say, you know what, I've never had them over before. I don't really know who they are. But guess what? At my next birthday party, they're invited. You will be rewarded. When we pursue hospitality with strangers, we show God's grace, we identify with Christ, we meet angels and participate in the progress of the gospel. Are you convinced yet? Better yet, are you convicted yet? Secondly today, pursue hospitality with one another. You know, that's really the emphasis of Peter's mandate as we look back to 1 Peter 4:9. Offer hospitality, and he uses the phrase, to one another. In other words, it's within the community. And I'm going to give you three reasons that we pursue hospitality even with one another. Number one, because it's a gospel-adorning good deed. A gospel-adorning good deed. Go with me to 1 Timothy chapter 5. This idea of doing good works in the book of Titus, several different ways he describes good works make the gospel attractive. Now, we've talked about that before, that the gospel is a concept. The gospel is words that describe the work of Christ. And what God does in the people of God is that through good deeds, he shows them the reality of the work of Christ in your life. Because you are doing deeds that the normal people in society do not do because they do not know Christ. That's the way that it is supposed to be. Gospel adorning good deeds. Now, I used to love to read Francis Schaeffer, and Francis Schaeffer was a philosopher and a theologian, and he used to have students come into his house on a regular basis. And he said that, I preach the gospel, but Edith, my wife, made it believable. I preached the gospel, but Edith made it believable. I'm going to tell you something. If you're here today, and you're a lady here today, I want you to listen to 1 Timothy chapter 5, verses 9 and 10, because it is you that is going to make the gospel believable to others, both within the church and outside the church. 1 Timothy 5, verse 9. No widow may be put on the list of widows unless she is over 60, has been faithful to her husband, and look at this, is well known for her good deeds, such as bringing up children, showing hospitality, washing the feet of the saints, and so, you know, this is the one another idea, and helping those in trouble and devoting herself to all kinds of good deeds. It is interesting, in the midst of all of these different and various good deeds, the first one he brings out is to bring up your children, and the second one is to show hospitality. In other words, if you're here today and you're the lady of a house, what is your main purpose in pleasing God? What is your number one good deed? Well, you raise your children. What's the number two good deed? It's to show hospitality. It's to show hospitality. It's a gospel-adorning good deed. You make the gospel believing, but when the people of God do not reach out to others that are within the body, we do not believe that which we hear in concept. We are to live it out. Number two, because it is the best context for service. Go back with me to 1 Peter, and I want you, remember we talk about the context of a verse, and that you're not going to understand verses properly and ideas properly in the scriptures unless you look at the context. A text without a context is a con. 1 Peter 4, and let's look at the context around verse 9. First of all, in verse 8, above all, love each other deeply, because love covers over a multitude of sins. And we talked about that last week, and hospitality now begins here as the number one expression of loving others in the love of Christ. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. But then look at verse 10. Each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. So you've been graced by God. You've been called by God. You've been saved by God through his wonderful grace. And he gives you the power, the resources, and the ability then to take that grace and through his gifting of your life, reach out to others in the context. And I believe the number one context for this service and this love is to be your home. We too often make it the church. You know, it's this building. Well, I'm going to tell you something. This building is empty most of the week. We come in here for some practices or to set up the sound or something like that a few hours. It's empty. There is nobody here. And you can go over to the church offices every Thursday from about 2:30 on, and we're there from about 2:30 till 9 o'clock at night, and there's fellowship. We have a great time, and we do work together. But that's it. For the other 6 days besides Sunday morning, it's empty. What does he say? We need, because of the grace of God in giving us gifts, to serve each other. And I'm going to tell you today, I believe that it is your home that is the best context for serving each other. Now, my wife sometimes struggles because she doesn't feel that she has the gifts that I have or that my daughters have. But I'm going to tell you something. The gifts that I have are extremely limited. Matter of fact, I struggle just talking in a one-on-one conversation. I have no idea why I can talk up in front of the church. But I really do struggle. And my wife looks at my daughters, and they lead ministries, and they write, and they just do some wonderful things. She says, well, you know, I'm not that useful in the kingdom, but you know what? She can cook, and she can talk. She can cook, and she can talk, and she takes my ministry and makes it believable. And she has gifts that I not only appreciate, I could never attain to. And I could never use day by day by day by day by day. How many times a week can you teach or preach? Not that often. But God has gifted her with the ability to be able to talk to those she does not know and to open up our house and to serve dinners and meals and have people over. And that's, and I'll tell you, that's a great, great, great gift in the kingdom of God that if it isn't being exercised in the church will suffer. The church will suffer. It's the best context for service. And if you're a lady here today, some guys can cook and some guys are good at talking. And then you do that. Use your home for that. But most of us guys, you know, can go, you know, whatever. And that, you know, it's usually our wives that really have the abilities to reach out to people in ways that we cannot. Because you mature the church community. Wasn't it the command of Peter here in verse 8, to love each other deeply? We also saw that in Peter 1:22, to love each other deeply. And that word deeply, ektenos in the Greek, means to stretch it to your limits. And it's used of taking a tent cord and stretching it out to pull a tent tight. In other words, love is not just to be, oh yeah, I love, I do this, I do that. No, you keep stretching it. You keep stretching it until you cannot possibly love anymore. You've used up your resources and your time in loving others. That's what he's talking about. Jesus showed love to people. He stretched it to the limits and he was crucified because of it. But almost nobody can look back at the life of Jesus and say he didn't show love. Matter of fact, when it got right down to it, Jesus would invite himself into people's homes. You know Zacchaeus, don't you? What did he say to Zacchaeus? He said, Zacchaeus, come down from that tree. I'm meeting at your house tonight. Now, I think we ought to have a rule in our church that all ministers of the gospel should be allowed to invite themselves over to your house for dinner. Base it on that text. And it's there that we, by showing hospitality, that we mature the church community as we encourage one another, as we build each other up, as we love each other deeply from the heart. And in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 16, it's when we begin to use our gifts together. I believe the home, the best context. And we use those gifts in the context of a house over a meal. That's where real Christian maturity comes to be. We hold each other accountable. We get to know each other. And we encourage each other and we build each other up and we become interested in other people's lives. And they feel the love of God and they become all that God intends them to become. It's only going to happen when the people of God, the mature people of God, which I believe most of you are here today, get serious about making hospitality a habit. Now, maybe you don't have a home, but there's other things that you can do. Invite yourself over to Scotty's house. Go out to eat. Say, I don't have the money. Save a dollar a week. As soon as you have enough money, you take someone else in the church out that you do not know. Be faithful. God's going to bless you. Will you commit yourself this morning in light of the grace of God to reach out and to regularly invite those that you do not know within this community and that come through those doors out of the West Allis community? Will you commit yourself to using your home as an outreach to them? Why has God given you a place to live? Why has God given you a home? Ray Netherly said this, it's in your notes. Christian community calls for careful handling of material possessions. Our homes, furnishings, conveniences, and money all belong to the Lord. They should be used up in serving God. It's not ours. They don't belong to us. If that's what we think, then we've misunderstood the blessings that God has given us. Here he says, Netherly says, they should be used up in serving God. Now in your midweeks this week, you can talk about what that means. What does it mean to use up that which God has given you to serve him? Now I'll ask you this morning as we close, what is your excuse for not adjusting your life, the way that you live, your resources, your home, to the mandates that have been set in Scripture relating to hospitality? Are you fully committed to serving Christ in this community? Are you fully committed to loving others deeply in this community? Are you committed today to be countercultural to the world and say, my home is not going to be a place of retreat. It's not going to be a place that's just for me where I can do what I want and nobody else can bother me, but it is going to be a place that God's grace is going to be demonstrated in my life to others. And people are going to come into my home and they're going to experience a little bit of the love of God and the character of God. And we're going to use our home to make the gospel of Christ believable. Will you commit yourselves this morning to taking your home and making it a place of hospitality? Let's pray. Father, thank you for your grace. Thank you for the gospel. That when we were strangers, you reached out to us. And you gave us the faith to believe. And you included us in your new community. And Lord, that we will forever have a home in heaven because you invited us in. And Lord, today I pray for your people that in each one of their hearts that you would help them this morning at this time to make a decision to be hospitable and to use the resources that you've given them to reach out to others. May it be done because Jesus is Lord. In his name we pray. Amen.